It's on.
Good morning, friends. We are running late today due to some technical difficulties which we could not resolve with our normal process of live streaming. So we have pulled out an iPhone and are live streaming with that this morning. We are aware that the audio will not be what you have become accustomed to, but we wanted to come and worship with you nonetheless. I am thinking about the special music that will be offered this morning, which is based on the wonderful words of Psalm 139. As we are here catching our breath after scrambling to fix our technical difficulties, we can be comforted and sustained by these words. Lord, you have searched me out. O Lord, you have known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. This God who knows us intimately, who knows the technical glitches of our lives, and who loves us deeply, is revealed in our worship today on the second Sunday after Epiphany as a God who calls to us, a God who claims us as his own and invites us to the work of the kingdom. Looking ahead into activities and events for coming days and weeks, we are beginning planning for the season of Lent, and I just make note of that with many announcements about Lenten activities coming up. I'll be making a note about that in my sermon as well. We are also beginning today receiving your contributions for the Super Bowl of Caring. The Super Bowl is on February 7th. I know some of you are waiting for me to say it. How about those Buffalo Bills? In any case, the Super Bowl of Caring is our annual in-gathering for the occasion of the Super Bowl. This year we are gathering in cans of soup, crackers, and cans of Spam to serve the Mannheim Food Pantry. So beginning this week until February 7th, we will be gathering those items in. In our prayers this morning, we lift up the family and friends of congregational member Lynn Rohr, who died on Friday, and we remember her, and we remember her family in our prayers. Our worship begins then with remembrance that in this Epiphany season, we are in a season of light and revelation. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Also with you.
Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day praising you with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading for today is from the Old Testament book of 1 Samuel, the 3rd chapter. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel!" And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." He said, "I did not call you, my son, lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." And Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip deceit. Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Creator, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our hymn of the day, following the sermon this morning, is a favorite in many congregations. This modern-day hymn is a dialogue between God and God's faithful, with a refrain inspired by today's Old Testament reading. "Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night." This hymn lifts up the scripture themes for our Epiphany worship today as well as next week. And this hymn points us to a God who calls, a God who summons the faithful to speak and serve God's holy purposes. "Here I am" is a response offered over and over again by God's people throughout Scripture. Abraham says, "Here I am," when he is called to go to the mountaintop with Isaac. Abraham's grandson Jacob says, "Here I am," when God summons him to return home and to face his estranged brother Esau. Moses declares, "Here I am," when he sees a burning bush. Samuel, as we heard, declares, "Here I am," when he hears a voice calling in the night. Isaiah declares, "Here I am," in the temple. Mary responded to the angel Gabriel, saying, "Here I am." And in the book of Acts, Ananias in Damascus heard God's voice in the days when Paul was persecuting the church, and he said, "Here I am." In every case, when someone says, "Here I am," he or she is about to be called out of their comfort zone and into service to God. In every case, the world is about to turn when someone says, "Here I am." When we sing, "Here I am," we are singing an ancient story of faith and courage and love. In order to get a handle on the story of Samuel for today, I went back and read the opening chapters of 1 Samuel. The call of Samuel takes place in the time of the judges, before Israel had come together as a nation, before there were kings. In the time of the judges, there were local and regional leaders, some faithful to God's ways, and many who fell short. Eli was one of those leaders. Now, in his heart, Eli knew what was good and right, but Eli failed to act and to lead according to God's ways. Eli's sons were especially egregious in their corruption and their abuse of power. And as the story tells us, Eli did not restrain them. The book of Judges tells us that in those days, all the people did what was right in their own eyes. And into this mess, into this world of sin, God calls a 12-year-old boy to speak truth against the old corrupt order and to prepare the people for a new day. 1 Samuel 3 is one of those memorable, classic Old Testament stories offering important and abundant insights about God and God's ways. If we want to understand what it means to be called by God, if we want to understand what it means to declare, "Here I am," the story is a pretty good starting point. is how hard it was for Samuel to recognize God's voice and presence. Even though Samuel had spent most of his life serving in the temple, even though he slept near the ark of the Lord's presence, we are told that Samuel did not yet know the Lord. It seems that he did not yet have any personal relationship with God. In addition, the word of the Lord was rare in those days, so Samuel had no reason to expect that God was at work in the world or would ever speak to him. Samuel's experience suggests that recognizing God's voice is not necessarily easy, not necessarily self-evident. Samuel needed to learn about God. He needed to learn to distinguish God's voice from every other voice. He needed to learn how to discern what God was speaking to him, just as we all need to learn these things. In the end, Samuel needed help learning, and that help came, if even from a flawed teacher like Eli. This point is essential around discernment. Learning to listen, learning to discern God's call is never a solo act. Growth towards God and discernment are rightly practiced in conversation and community with others. Discernment of God's call is a relational process, and God works with and in our brokenness for the sake of healing and new life. Just as Samuel needed Eli, we need each other to grow towards God, and we need each other to hear rightly. Now, oftentimes in our Sunday school lessons, and even in our Sunday morning reading of this story, The Call of Samuel, the story will end basically at verse 10. But verses 11 through 20 are significant, for they show us that God called Samuel to speak a hard and uncomfortable truth. God called Samuel to speak judgment to Eli. And then verse 15 tells us that Samuel was afraid to do this. If we think about all of the biblical witnesses who said, "Here I am," from Abraham to Moses to Ananias, it seems that God's call to witness and God's call to speak the truth unsettles and it discomforts, beginning with the one being called. It is often said that God's servants are called to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. And what an uncomfortable responsibility that is. This is true for Samuel, as it was for Martin Luther, and Martin Luther King, remembered this weekend, and for all the prophets God has called to speak to us today. Another thing to note about today's story is that the phrase, "Here I am," is not actually the key to Revelation. It is not the turning point in Samuel's call. Rather, the climax and the heart of the story flow from Samuel's response, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." It turns out that saying, "Here I am," is only the first step. Only when Samuel declares his willingness to listen does he finally recognize the voice of the Lord. "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening," is an expression of humility and receptivity. These words proclaim a willingness to open our ears and our hearts to God. Declaring, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening," keeps us from rushing off to do what we think is our duty, our calling, before we have begun to discern God's thoughts on the matter. These words position us to live in God's time, to depend on God's instruction, to go deeper in faith. These words, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening," struck me this week and have begun to impact my own prayers and posture toward God. Out of everything that has been said and will be said in response to current events in our nation and world these days, a good starting point, the most humble and faithful response we can give might be to say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." In the midst of pandemic and politics and civil unrest, amidst the struggles that many are having to know what is true, amidst the loss and grief and weariness and frustration and despair and anger and fear that we share, Samuel's words are for a time such as this. "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." To say these words with honest, open hearts and to take the time to listen is a profound spiritual discipline we need to cultivate and practice when there is so much noise and confusion all around. Listening, really listening, without assumptions or preconceived answers, is an act of love. And when we are humble and open enough to listen for God, we will experience more deeply God's gifts of love and peace. For Samuel raises all sorts of questions about who or what we are listening to. It raises the question of how it is we might listen for God's word and call. In my experience as a pastor for 20 plus years, only a few people have ever shared the experience of hearing in a distinct way the voice of God, as Samuel seems to have heard. Most often people talk about a still small voice, or a nudge, or a slowly dawning realization. Sometimes, as members of the Tuesday small group have shared, a realization hits and God's voice or God's message hits us like the whack of a 2x4 on the back of the head. Scripture is clear that God speaks in many and various ways, in dreams, in the words of the prophets, in the stars in the sky, and most often through the faithful witness and service of ordinary men and women, like our parents and grandparents and neighbors. Christian tradition tells us that God speaks in the words of Scripture and in the sacraments, and ultimately God speaks in that word made flesh, in that unlikely teacher from Nazareth who taught us the way of cross-shaped love. I wonder who or what you are listening to these days. There's no shortage of options competing for our attention. So here's an assignment, a spiritual practice for this season. Today, this week, this still new year, I invite you to prayerfully, regularly say those words spoken by Samuel. "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." During Lent, a few weeks from now, I'll be talking more about how we can listen, about cultivating and practicing spiritual disciplines to aid us in hearing and growing towards God. In the end, we can be encouraged in the story of Samuel's call that ultimately this is a story about God's persistence. Despite the sins of the people, despite failures of imagination and leadership, God is faithful. God does not abandon the people to wallow in their sin and to wander lost. No, God speaks. God calls. God breaks in and works to bring new possibilities to life. Time after time after time, God calls witnesses, prophets, new leaders, ordinary men and women. God speaks, and God calls the likes of you and me for the sake of God. in calling the boy Samuel, God speaks not once, not twice, but four times before the message is received. When our eyesight is dim, when we have trouble hearing, when we don't know which way to turn, our God is faithful. Our God is persistent. Our God loves us with a love that does not let us go. What better way to show our love and faith in response to this God than to say with Samuel, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." Amen. Goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, taking a moment for silent reflection and trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away and we are forgiven. Claimed as God's own beloved, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace.
Amen.
Sisters and brothers, rejoice, mend your ways, encourage one another, agree with one another, live in peace. And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We share a sign of peace with one another. Peace.
Lord, you have searched me, you know I crave thee.
receive us like a mother receives her child with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care and empower us in faithful service to tend others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen. The prayers of the people this morning are adapted from prayers offered by the presiding bishop of the ELCA, Elizabeth Eaton, as we look to a week of transition of power marked by uncertainty and civil discord. Let us pray. Mighty God, ever-present help in times of trouble, we come to you in prayer this day, seeking your wisdom, strength, and peace, asking you to speak through the noise, asking you to help us learn to listen. We pray for the health of our own nation and our democracy. We pray for our leaders, that those elected to serve may exercise their office in ways that promote human flourishing and the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who risk harm to ensure the safety of others, police officers, security guards, the National Guard, and other military personnel, especially our brother Tyler. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for an end to the evils of white supremacy, Christian nationalism, and racial violence that threatens, destroys, and kills. We pray for those experiencing trauma from the events of January 6th and those whose trauma is induced by the display and use of hateful language and symbols, including Confederate flags, anti-Semitic language and images and uses. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for clergy and church leaders, especially for those burdened by mistrust and painful divisions in their own communities. Give all your people the courage to confront sin, to confront and name white supremacy, Christian nationalism, and racist rhetoric with messages of truth, sustained by the power of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for people and communities struggling to discern your voice amid competing voices clamoring for attention. Direct us to listen deeply and celebrate the diversity among us. Help us to know that we are freed in Christ and so empowered to witness to your abundant life and abiding peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for President-elect Biden, Vice President-elect Harris, and for all elected officials, that they fulfill their obligations to the Constitution and work together in ways that serve the needs of this nation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all whose hearts are filled with hatred, whose eyes are blinded by bigotry, and whose minds are bent to violence, that they may be transformed and renewed in repentance by the power of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray that you bring health to the sick, comfort to the dying, grace to those who grieve, resilience to frontline workers, wisdom to those involved with vaccines, and a lasting end to the coronavirus pandemic. We pray for all those we know this day in need of your healing mercy and gracious presence, especially George, Patricia, Helen, friends and family of Lynn Rohr, those on our prayer list and others we name in our hearts before you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your wide and merciful embrace, we commend these prayers and the prayers of our hearts, trusting in your goodness, for it has been revealed to us in your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Light of Christ.